where we find our source of love and strength. So this is what he wrote. Although I speak with tongues of men and of angels, and though I prophesy and understand all, and though I have all faith so mountains may be removed, and though I feed the poor and give up my life, if I have not charity, if love does not flow from me, I am nothing. Jesus, reduce me to love. And then I might come in singing something that you might find very familiar. So thank you for being here today. I hope you enjoy our service and the music that binds us all together.
Welcome you to worship on this fifth Sunday of Easter, if I can get my mic situated correctly. Just a reminder to please take the registration card and fill that out so we know that you were here this morning. Just a couple of announcements. We had our annual meeting this morning, our May meeting, to say thank you to our outgoing council members and to elect our new incoming council members. So I want to say thank you if you were here for that meeting, as we were able to do that. There are new council members. I'm not thinking clearly this morning about all of the names, but those names will be published here so that you know who they are, our new council members are. Coming up next week, remember this is the last Sunday where we have two services until after September 9th. So next week we will worship at 9:30, a combined worship service. And please take note of that on your calendar. And I think my hope this summer is that we can be a little bit more lighthearted. Not that we aren't already, but to be a little more casual, to have a little bit of fun and play a little bit this summer. We have a lot of interesting and really neat things that are happening week by week. And our engagement team, Rick Miller, has provided a kind of a synopsis sheet that will be posted in the gathering space so you can see each week we're going to be doing something different. We're going to keep you on your toes this summer. So I want to say thank you to everyone who has helped to plan those with Tina and Bev and Rick and our musicians. I want to say thank you to all of you who
Pastor
are
Glenn.
Participating. And Pastor Glenn, of course, how could we forget him? Prayers go out to former members, family, Joe Ranieri. Dr. Joe passed away recently. He has been gone. His family's been gone for 30 years, but that they're going to have another service that we're able to host here on Tuesday at 11 o'clock. So if you're have been a longtime member and remember him or his family, I encourage you to be here for that with a funeral luncheon following at 11:30. Those are all of our announcements. Again, welcome, and let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship as we stand as you're able for our confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for you and die for us, and for his sake forgives us of all of our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I declare to you the entire forgiveness of all of your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. Let us continue with our gathering song, Sing Out Earth and Skies.
Okay, we're going to go ahead and do all the verses. Since this is new, it's going to take a little while, and it goes really quick. It's light and dancing. Hopefully your knees will be bouncing a little bit, so Lloyd will help us out on that. Here we go. One.
Life around you.
Verse 2. Come, O God of wind and flame,
fill the earth with righteousness.
Teach us all to sing your name.
May your light your love confess. Sing of earth and skies. Sing of the God who loves you. Praise your joyful cries. Dance to the life around you. Star and burning sun.
Come, O day of God of night,
in your light we all are one. Sing out earth and skies, sing of the God who loves you. Raise your joyful cries, dance to the life around you. Sing of the God who loves you. Raise your joyful cries. Dance to the life around you.
Here we go, last one. Come, O just
Come and shape our hearts anew.
Come and make oppression cease.
Bring us all to life in you. Sing out earth and skies. Sing of the God who loves you. Raise your joyful cries. Dance to the life around you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O Lord God, you teach us that without love, our actions gain nothing. Pour into our hearts your most excellent gift of love, that made alive by your Spirit, we may know goodness and peace through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Be seated, please.
Presents? Good morning. Our first reading this morning is from the book of Acts. Now the apostles and the believers who were in Judea heard that the Gentiles had also accepted the word of God. So when Peter went up to Jerusalem, the circumcised believers criticized him, saying, "Why did you go to uncircumcised men and eat with them?" Then Peter began to explain it to them, step by step, saying, "I was in the city of Joppa praying, and in a trance I saw a vision. There was something like a large sheet coming down from heaven, being lowered by its four corners, and it came close to me. As I looked at it closely, I saw four-footed animals, beasts of prey, reptiles, and birds of the air. I also heard a voice saying to me, 'Get up, Peter, kill and eat.' But I replied, 'By no means, Lord, for nothing profane or unclean has ever entered my mouth.' But a second time the voice answered from heaven, 'What God has made clean, you must not call profane.' This happened three times, then everything was pulled up again to heaven. At that very moment, three men sent to me from Sisera arrived at the house where we were. The Spirit told me to go with them and not to make a distinction between them and us. These six brothers also accompanied me, and we entered the man's house. He told us how he had seen the angel standing in the house and saying, 'Send to Joppa and bring Simon, who is called Peter. He will give you a message by which you and your entire household will be saved.' And as I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell upon them just as it had upon us at the beginning. And I remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said, 'John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit.' If then God gave them the same gift that he gave us when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could hinder God?" When they heard this, they were silenced, and they praised God, saying, "Then God has given even to the Gentiles the repentance that leads to life." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The splendor
of the Lord is over earth and heaven.
Alleluia. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise God in the heights. Praise the Lord, all you angels. Sing praise, all you hosts of heaven. Praise the Lord, sun and moon. Sing praise, all you shining stars. Praise the Lord, heaven of heavens, and you waters above the heavens. Let them praise the name of the Lord who commanded, and they were created, who made them stand fast forever and ever, giving them a law that shall not pass away.
The splendor of the Lord is over earth and heaven.
Praise the Lord from the earth, you sea monsters and all deeps, fire and hail, snow and fog, tempestuous wind, doing God's will, mountains and all hills, fruit trees and all cedars, wild beasts and all cattle, creeping things and flying birds, sovereigns of the earth and all peoples, princes and all rulers of the world, young men and maidens, old and young together.
The splendor of the Lord is over earth and heaven.
Let them praise the name of the Lord, whose name only is exalted, whose splendor is over earth and heaven. The Lord has raised up strength for the people and praise for all faithful servants. The children of Israel, a people who are near the Lord. Alleluia.
The splendor of the Lord is over earth and heaven.
Our second reading this morning is from the book of Revelation. I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them, and they will be his peoples. And God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more. For the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Krishna, please stand as you're able. Gospel according to St. John, the 13th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. When he had gone out, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another, just as I have loved you. You also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Congregation, be seated. I'd like to invite our children forward for our children's message. Good morning. How's everybody today? You know, one of my favorite things to do in the summer is go to the zoo. How many of you like to go to the Henry Dorley Zoo? Yeah? Yeah, that's a fun place, isn't it? And you go and you visit the animals, and I thought I'd bring some animals here today, and I'm going to show you the animal, and you tell me how you know which animal it is. This is a?
Elephant.
It's an elephant. Now, how do you know? How would you describe the elephant?
Elephant has big
ears, big floppy ears. What else does the elephant have?
Elephant has big
feet. He's just big all around, isn't he? How about this up front? A trunk. Yeah. So there's no other animal on planet Earth that looks quite like the elephant, is there? All right. There's the elephant. Okay. Now, what is this guy?
Monkey.
A monkey. How do you know it's a monkey? He eats bananas. Yeah, that's true. He does. And he has a tail. And he has, you can't really see it here, but monkeys have fingers like we do, don't they? And a white belly. So we know that's a monkey, right? Face looks very monkey-like too, doesn't it? All right, what's this?
A dog.
A dog. Now, how do you know it's a dog?
Because it has a tail, and it has a collar.
Collar.
Spots.
Spots.
Ears
and a cold, wet nose, mm-hmm. and probably barks. Mm-hmm. All right. All right. Yeah. All right. Now, what's this?
Penguin.
How do you know it's a penguin?
Because it's, it has a white belly.
White belly. It's got what's that?
A beak.
And the colors are distinct. And it's got, what are these things? Little feathers and wings. It can help it do what else? It can't fly. It swims, though, doesn't it? Okay, how about this? Do you know what this is?
It's a frog.
It's a frog. How do you know that's a frog?
Because it's green.
It's green.
It has these eyes.
The eyes stick up off the top of his head. He's looking at you. You guys.
It can move its
head. And what does it do?
Jumping.
It jumps. Okay. And then, last but not least, we have our friend what?
Giraffe.
The giraffe. And how do you know it's a giraffe?
Because it's
long. Long legs and what? And brown spots. Yep. What else?
And it's one of the fewest animals that has horns.
Is it really? One of the fewest animals that has horns. I learned something new today. And you can just tell, you know what I think is cool about the giraffe? Is it has really long what? Eyelashes. Isn't that neat? All right. So in today's gospel, Jesus talks about his followers, and he describes them in a way. How does he describe us as his disciples? Do you know? That we'll know. We know a giraffe by its spots and its long legs. We know a frog by the way his eyes are up on the top of his head, and the elephant by his big ears and his trunk, and the penguin by his beak. How do we know that we're followers of Jesus? What do we look like? Are we the best looking people on earth?
No.
No. Are we the smartest people on earth? Are we the wealthiest? Do we have the most money?
No.
No. What? Okay. What is it?
We're special.
We're special. Okay. That's a good answer. That's a good start. How are we special? We're kind to each other. How else, Haley? We believe in God, and even though we sin, yeah. And we believe that Jesus forgives us of that sin too, right? Jesus says that you will know one another by sharing my love. And those are the kinds of things that help describe us as Christians, by how we love one another. What does that look like? You kind of said it before, Nina. It's being kind, huh? Being we love one another by serving each other, by forgiving each other, kind of like what you mentioned, Haley, by being kind to one another and helping give to our neighbors the things, treat them the way they want to be treated, and help give them things that they might need, like food or water if they're hungry and thirsty, or clothes if they don't have any. There's all kinds of ways that we show God's love, isn't there? And that's what we look like. We have a very distinct look, and that look is by loving one another, and that's the cool thing. So you can tell that each of us has distinguishing features by God's love. Let's pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for these youth and for the gift of your faith, for all of us here who are reminded again of your love and what that means, what that looks like in this world and in our lives. Help us to be marked by your love and by your cross as we share that with the world. In your name we pray. Amen. Thanks for coming up today. We're going to leave it there for now. When Jesus prepared disciples for his departure, I often wonder how those disciples felt. As Jesus was preparing for the cross, I wonder if those disciples were scared. Were they angry? Were they confused? Were the disciples grieving over the fact that they were about to lose someone that they love? Or was it a combination of all of the above? After all, remember, these disciples weren't just followers. They had become friends with Jesus. They were united together under the one mission to follow their Lord and Rabbi, to learn from his wisdom and his teachings, to eat with Jesus, especially as he dined with those who were considered sinners and outcasts, those who were on the fringes and periphery of society. They were part of his ministry of healing and of prayer. And so when Jesus was preparing to leave his friends, his disciples, they must have wondered to themselves, what's next? What in the world am I going to do? What is on the agenda now? What will our lives be about? They might have wondered if they were going to remain together, unified as a small band of followers who had been profoundly influenced by Jesus. Or would they choose to go their own separate ways, perhaps to go back to their life of fishing or go back to their family situations? And that's when Jesus in John's Gospel in the 13th chapter drops what I think is just an absolute bomb in the lap of these disciples about what was truly to be next on the agenda. Jesus says, I give you a new commandment, that you love one another just as I have loved you. You should love one another. By this everyone will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. Seems simple enough to hear, right? But it's interesting, after Jesus speaks these words in the rest of the story in John's 13th chapter, the disciples are crickets. They are silent. They don't say a word about what that love means. They don't ask questions. They don't ask for clarification. They certainly don't rally behind Jesus with newfound enthusiasm to get behind and follow. Instead, all indications in John's gospel point to a little bit of anxiety, maybe a lot of anxiety, about obeying this commandment to be alone apart from Jesus and to share this love by themselves. That's when Peter asks anxiously in the next part, if you open up your Bible sometime and look. He says, Lord, where are you going? And I imagine him asking just like that, "Where in the world are you going? I don't understand." And this, of course, is when Jesus simultaneously answers both Peter's question in that moment about where he is going, and then also sets the standard, the bar high for his brand of love, saying, "I will lay down my life for you, Peter. I will lay down my life for you." And so today we come yet again to the part of Scripture that most of us are really familiar with, aren't we? This commandment to love one another. We last heard this commandment in Holy Week on Maundy, Thursday. Maundy meaning mandatum or commandment to love one another. And we talked about what that love looks like as Jesus washes the feet of the disciples. How many times have you and I heard those kinds of sermons about love? How many times have you and I waxed nostalgic, perhaps, about Christian love as the benchmark behavior for living our lives as followers, as disciples, as Christians? How many times have you heard sermons, perhaps by me or of others, that asked you to reflect carefully about all of the ways that you and I are called to express that love in community, the love of Christ for our neighbor? My guess is that it's an awful lot. And we've heard more sermons about Christian love than just about anything else in Scripture. After all, it was C.S. Lewis in his book, he writes about the four loves. He writes, "Every Christian would agree that a man's or a woman's spiritual health is exactly proportional to his or her love for God." That our spiritual health is exactly proportional to our love of God. And then, of course, we come to worship and we hear songs and we sing songs like, "They'll know that we are Christians by our love, by our love. They'll know that we are Christians by our love." And yet, if C.S. Lewis and the hymn writer are correct, I'm not so sure that I even myself can claim even a fraction of the time, a fraction of my own day, worthy of being all that spiritual or even all that great at loving. Sometimes I'm pretty lousy at it. And I'm lousy because we live in a world, remember, in which sharing the love of Christ means laying down one's life, of getting over ourselves. And of course, when we do that in this world, it is not intuitive to do such things. It's not that simple. Sharing our love, Christian love, can be messy. And sometimes it's not even all that rewarding either. And bear with me now as I am a little cynical, but love seems to be easy when I get to love people who look exactly like I do. Love is easy when I encounter people who think like I do. Love is easy when I encounter people who have the same values that I do. Love is easy when it's returned back to me, when it's reciprocated. Love is great when it's appreciated, when it's recognized. Love is easy when I can read about it, talk about it, think and dream about that kind of love. And even romantic love, like that picture-perfect kind that you drive to the movie theaters to see, that seems so easy, longed for, cherished. And when love is framed in such ways, that kind of love seems approachable. It even seems quite charming too, doesn't it? After all, everybody appreciates a great love story, don't they? And so I wonder, why is Jesus' difficult mandate or commandment to love one another so important in this world anyway? especially when we encounter people who we don't like so much, who we don't understand, who we struggle with. Stephen Olford tells the story of a pastor during the American Revolution. His name was Peter Miller. He enjoyed, what was distinct about Peter Miller was he enjoyed a friendship with George Washington. And where Pastor Miller lived in Pennsylvania, there also lived a man by the name of Michael Whitman, who was infamous for being considered a mean-spirited soul. Whitman did everything he could to oppose and humiliate and try to sabotage this pastor and his ministry. But one day, Whitman was arrested for treason, and he was sentenced to die. And Pastor Miller thought to himself, what should I do? What does love really mean in this moment? And so he traveled by foot, walking 70 miles to Philadelphia to plead for the life of this traitor, because that's what the pastor felt in his heart that he should do. No, Peter, General Washington said, I cannot grant you the life of your friend. My friend? Cried the preacher. He's not my friend. He's the bitterest enemy that I have. What? Yelled Washington. You mean you tell me you walked 70 miles to save the life of a man who's your enemy? Well, that puts the matter in a totally different light. I'll grant you that pardon. And Washington was good on his promise. And when love entered into the equation, when love became part of the fabric between these enemies, if you will, it was Pastor Peter Miller who walked with Michael Whitman all the way back home, arm to arm, two no longer enemies, but rather friends. Maybe that's an extreme example about how love can be so transformative in our own lives. And yet when Jesus tells the disciple Peter that his commandment to love is about laying down his life, remember that laying down his life runs much deeper than just simply dying on the cross and calling it good. That death that Jesus experiences on the cross is much deeper as a model for love for each of us in our lives. That it reframes how each of us live out our baptismal calling daily. That it teaches us to see this world in a different light, in different ways. To see enemies, perhaps, as people that we can love. To see people that we don't like, perhaps, as possible friends. That instead of seeing opportunities for retribution, that we do our best to seek restoration. That instead of seeing the need to punish, that we might instead value forgiveness. That instead of looking to get even or to be paying others back for their misdeeds, that we see the opportunity, perhaps, to err on the side of grace, and to connect with and to understand others despite our differences. Perhaps one way of seeing the world differently through the gift of Jesus' love is to take the advice of Pastor Sharon Blizzard, and she uses the letter of the word love, L-O-V-E, to help remind us of some of the possibilities. No, it's not an exhaustive list, but some of the possibilities for helping us to understand this commandment to love and what it might actually mean as we live that love out in our lives. And so we might look at L as it stands for listen. To listen carefully the ones that we might be called to love, and to hear and to appreciate what others have to say about their thoughts, about their feelings, about their experiences as it's unique or distinct from our own. And so I ask, how might you be finding opportunities to listen to others these days? The O might stand for being open-minded, open to the new possibilities that are guided by God's Spirit, possibilities for others and ourselves and our communities, to be open to the new things that God is doing in our midst. Remember in our Revelation text that Stacy read, that God does not make all new things. That's not the promise. God doesn't make all new things. He makes all things new. He restores and transforms and works with what has been created and broken. He makes those things new. And so how, I might ask, how might you be open to the Holy Spirit's guidance in overcoming fear, in order to risk perhaps being more vulnerable with others and avoid the pitfalls of prejudice and judgment in the process? V could stand for visible. That is, that in sharing the light of Christ, love and light are always transparent. They are always visible for the world to see. Remember in the gospel, Jesus never hid from sinners. He never hid from those who were considered unclean. Rather, just the opposite. He ate with everyone. He ate with those who were considered outcasts. And he restored them to community. He invited them, in the case of Nicodemus, to come into the light. And he made sure that everyone, including the Roman authorities and the temple elite, saw what he was doing. God is made visible in the person of Jesus Christ. And so I ask, how might you make Christ's radical love visible in the coming days and week to come? And finally, E might stand for engage. In other words, love doesn't sit alone in solitude waiting for things to happen. It doesn't sit and think about what it should do. Love is active. Love is a verb, and it enters into relationships with others in the community or in your family. Yes, life and love can be messy. Love can be painful. Losing a loved one can make us grieve and long for more of their love. And giving away love to someone else can be risky, especially if it isn't returned. But remember that God has given us a great gift in community to live out his love with one another. And so I ask, how might you find one new way to engage in an active and radical love for your neighbor, or perhaps in a ministry here at Morningstar? Or perhaps in a way that you're thinking quietly to yourself. Friends, the point of the sermon this morning is that Christ's commandment to love is not always easy. And sometimes we find it difficult to extend our love. Sometimes we find it difficult to forgive. And sometimes we put up barriers before we even try. And sometimes we decide that because we don't like someone, that perhaps they're not worthy of our love. Truth be told, sometimes we flat out fail at obeying God's greatest commandment. But you know what? It's worth every single bit of effort that you and I make. It's worth it because we're reminded first and foremost that Jesus did not die on the cross simply to make God more loving. He died in order to demonstrate that God is pure love for this world. And that God finally is with us to help us in sharing that love. And whether we succeed or fail in engaging this world in love. Remember that you and I have been granted a tremendous freedom by what God has done for us on the cross. The freedom to keep on trying, to keep on learning and yearning, and finally to know once and for all that we are never alone in sharing God's love. Because finally, God has promised to be with us, to share in the good news that each one of us, each one of you, is worthy of God's eternal and freely given love, no matter what. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks again for your commandment to love. We can't hear this commandment often enough in our lives. We need to know that you love us, that in our yearning for acceptance and love in our lives, that you have claimed us as your own unconditionally. Help us to not take that for granted. But Lord, you also know how difficult it is sometimes for us to extend your love in the world. Help us to overcome barriers and challenges where they exist. Help us to perhaps get over ourselves where needed. But help us and encourage us, give us strength to share in this wonderful commandment that you give to each of us. And help us in our mission as a congregation to continue to love one another. In your name we pray. Amen.
Unless they, we need to sing it a second time, and then it's all of us the second time.
So do we stay up here?
Mm-hmm. Oh.
Mm-hmm. I don't know if we have to. Mm-hmm. That's all we have. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Each one's pride.
And they'll know we are Christians by our love. By our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. All praise to the Father, from whom all things come. And all praise to Christ Jesus, His only Son. And all praise to the Spirit who makes us one. Then they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
Let us confess our faith through the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Trusting God's promise of new life, let us pray for the renewal of the church, for the world, and all of God's creation. Let us pray. Send your Holy Spirit upon your church. Awaken in us renewed commitment to our baptismal promises, to build community, to worship together, to share our faith, to serve others, and to work for justice and peace. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Forgive us for the ways we have caused creation to suffer. Inspire creativity as we explore new ways of reducing our consumption of Earth's resources. Restore the forests and waterways. Replenish the habitats of all endangered and threatened species. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Call all nations to the repentance that leads to life. Empower legislators to craft laws that reflect your commandments to love and to serve our neighbor. Bless police officers and firefighters, paramedics and first responders, those who put themselves at risk to care for others. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Make your home among us and shelter us from the storms of death or mourning, crying and pain. Draw near to those who weep, to those who are lonely. Restore health and wholeness to all who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. We pray for Cecil Bykirk and Deb Hysack, for Marilyn Girard and Gloria Miller, for Maxine Wingy and Bill Winstrom. And Lord, we pray for the family and loved ones of Joe Rainieri on his death. And Lord, we lift up to you those loved ones who we hold in the silence of our hearts. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. We give you thanks for those who carry out the ministry of hospitality in this congregation, for greeters and ushers, for those who make coffee and prepare meals, for those who work with our funeral luncheons, and all who welcome newcomers, for those who care for children, for our musicians here today, and all who extend a hand of peace to our neighbors. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Lord, you promise new life for all the faithful departed. Renew us in faith and hope until the day death is no more, when you will dwell with us in the new heaven and new earth. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. We commend these and all our prayers to you, O God. Come near to us with your saving help for the sake of Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Also with you.
Let's turn and share that peace with one another.
Peace be with you.
Peace with you, Rick.
Peace with you.
Peace with you.
Peace with you.
Morning, team. Peace with you.
Morning, Lori.
Peace with you.
God's peace be with you.
God's peace be with you, Frank.
Frank.
We continue our worship by sharing our gifts and our offerings. To please stand. Risen one, as you broke bread with the disciples on the shore, meet us now in this meal. Nourish us to follow you, using our gifts to feed the hungry, to tend the weary, and all for your love's sake. Amen. Amen. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples to eat. saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord's table has been prepared, and all are invited. Be seated, please.
To you, my love. I invite the congregation to stand as you're able. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. Living God, you have greeted us in our brokenness and nourished us with the body of Christ, broken for us. Risen to new life with you, send us now to bear your healing love into the wounded world. In the name of our risen Savior and Lord. Amen. And now the blessing of the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit surround and sustain you to keep you from harm and to fill you with courage.
Amen.
Amen. Remember that you are the body of Christ raised up for the world. Go now in peace and share the good news. Alleluia. Thanks be to God.